Congressman Jerry Litton believes that a democracy depends on informed people. He also believes our government should be more open and accessible to the people. To better inform the people of what is happening in their government, Congressman Litton of Missouri's 6th District invites Washington personalities to come to Missouri each month and join him in an unrehearsed question and answer open to the public town meeting to discuss key issues facing our nation. Dialogue with Litton brings you closer to our government and Washington closer to you. Hello, I'm Melinda Mindenhall, speaking to you from the Plaza Inn International at the Kansas City International Airport, where each month Congressman Jerry Litton brings you his monthly public meeting, Dialogue with Litton. The crowd looks eager and ready to start their questions with Congressman Litton and Congressman Wayne Hayes, who is our guest today. So I think I'll step down into the crowd and just find out what's on a few of the people's minds and what questions might be asked here today. Hi. What do you think's on the minds of all these people here today?
I think they like information from Washington, mm-hmm. right from the horse's mouth.
Right from the horse's mouth. That's good. But what do you think really is on the minds of the people today with our guest?
Well, I think with the guest in person.
Congressman Wayne Hayes.
He sounds very interesting to me. Mm-hmm. He sounds like he certainly has a mind of his own, if what I can believe this is.
Well, we'll find out here today. Hi there.
Hi there.
What brings you out to Congressman Litton's meeting? Oh, why do you think all these people are here today?
Oh, I think they're just interested in what's going on from their federal government standpoint.
What do you think specifically is on their minds today?
Probably Vietnam. It is mine anyway. What's going on over there? And I think that all the people are interested in that.
But what do you think's on the minds of the people here today?
Economy, the future, and also this asinine situation in Cambodia and Vietnam.
Here's a man here. What do you think, sir, is on the minds of the people here today?
Well, at the present moment, the Vietnam collapse is probably the thing in the public attention. However, the economy and our domestic issues are still very important.
I think Tony DiPardo and his Kansas City Chiefs Orchestra Band is ready to start the Dialogue with Litton meeting, so I'll turn the program over to Tony.
Ladies and gentlemen, our host for Dialogue with Litton, Congressman Jerry Litton. Let's hear it.
A great crowd. I think we can outdraw the Kansas City Chiefs this year. And you know, it's interesting that you people would have enough interest in your country to come out to these meetings each month and participate in a public town meeting like this. And I think we're fortunate in that we have the eyes and the ears of television and radio to make the size of this ballroom substantially larger so as to accommodate about 500,000 people who participate with us in their living rooms each month, too. And I'm sure the Founding Fathers didn't envision those kind of public town meeting. I'm sure they had no idea that our world would be as it is today and that the United States would play the kind of role that it's playing now. We have a man with us who has played a very important role in foreign affairs in our country in the last 20-some years. He's on a first-name basis with many leaders of the world. He's one of the most knowledgeable experts in the area of foreign affairs in the entire United States Congress. He's second-ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee. He's headed up the House delegation to NATO's conference every year for 20 years. For 4 years, he's served as chairman of the NATO conference, as he will this year. In addition to his knowledge in foreign affairs, he's chairman of the House Administration Committee, and as some will tell you in Congress, that means he runs Congress, and he does that very well, too. He's a candid man who always tells it like he sees it. As a matter of fact, he's been doing that long before Watergate made it popular. And I tell friends of mine that our guest today is candid and has the candor of a Harry Truman before being moderated by Bess. People here understand that. Let's give a warm Missouri welcome to our guest today, Congressman Wayne Hayes from Ohio.
I'm glad to be your guest, and I just want to tell you folks, I guess you already know this, that Jerry and I both have a farm background, but he has more exquisitely balanced the interests of the consumers and the farmers than anybody I know of in Congress, and I'm always watching him to try to learn how to do it. Because I also represent a district that has 4 agricultural counties and 5 industrial counties, and I find that those people think that their interests lie in different directions a lot of times. Really they don't. What's good for the farmer is generally good for the consumer and vice versa. It's sometimes the middleman that gets us into trouble. But anyway, I'm not here to make a speech. We're here to answer your questions if we can, and I'm just delighted to be here in Missouri again. Thank you.
I understand you could have been somewhere else this weekend.
Well, I could have been. The president asked me to go to Taiwan to represent him from the House at Chiang Kai-shek's funeral. And I told him I couldn't go because I had made a commitment to you. After I found out who was then going to head up the delegation, I was glad I had the commitment. It was supposed to be Secretary Butts. But Goldwater raised such a fuss about that, they took him off and put the vice president on in his place, and I'm not any sure that I wanted to ride to Taiwan with him than I would have been with Butts.
We have microphones in the audience. We never know, Wayne, what kind of questions are going to come up, but we'll let the people come to the mic. I'd ask that you please give your name and your town. We'll see what happens. Question right here.
In light of the recent developments in the Middle East, the assassination of King Faisal in Saudi Arabia and the breakdown of Kissinger's shuttle diplomacy, where is the United States policy towards Israel at the present time, and what differences are there in this policy between the White House and Congress?
I think our policy to Israel is the same it's always been, that if they do the fighting, we'll provide them up to a reasonable degree with the equipment to do it with. Now, you come to a rather fine distinction there, and no matter what I say on this, somebody's going to get upset, but do we provide them money to go on the offensive, or do we just provide them money in arms for defense? And what do we do about the Arab lands they've occupied, and what should they do? And I think this is a policy that the Israelis and hopefully the Arabs have got to negotiate out. I went out to the Middle East, and in fact, I left home on Christmas Day at noon at the request of Henry Kissinger, and I mainly talked to the Turks and Greeks about Cyprus, but I did stop off in Egypt and talk to President Sadat, and I really think that Sadat wants peace. I think he sees no future in a war for him or his country, another war.
Well, I think one of the things that we were advised within the State Department was that when Faisal got assassinated, that his replacement, and I guess really the power behind the replacement, is just as pro-American as is Faisal, but Faisal was both a political leader and a religious leader.
That's right.
Consequently, it's going to be very difficult to get someone to step into his shoes and be able to have the weight and power that he did within the Arab world.
Well, Prince Fahd, who's supposed to be the power behind the throne there now that King Khalid is on the throne, is not exactly the religious leader that Faisal was. He's more noted for his losses at Monte Carlo and his stable of good-looking girls. And That doesn't necessarily hurt him in the Islamic religion, but on the other hand, he's not noted for wanting to go to Mecca and pray and so on.
Question right over here.
Congressman Mark Patton, KUSA News, St. Joseph. Why do you think President Ford made such an unbelievable request when you take into account the mood of this country? The reaction I've seen from Congress, for the most part, and from the American public is that they can't believe the president would actually ask for $722 million to aid Vietnam when we should have learned a bitter lesson there already. That's number one. Number two, did he make the request because of secret side agreements that were made in the Paris Peace Accords? And number three, is Dr. Kissinger's power as a peacemaker now deteriorating?
We take them in reverse order or in the order they were given. Wayne and I may not agree on this, but I was a little surprised when the president spoke. The most important part of his speech really was a request for $722 million. And I detected he was very deliberate and very precise and very careful in his entire speech until he came to $722 million. And then he passed over it very quickly, almost as if to say, there, I said it, I'm glad I said it, and now it's over with and we'll move on to the rest. I can't think that the people around the president would have thought that he had support in Congress or in America for $722 million in military aid. I felt that he was saying it because he felt he had to say it, not because he thought he would get it. I don't intend to vote for it. I'll let Wayne speak his position on it.
Well, I think having benefited from the secret briefings of General Whalen, who was out there, he spoke to us for an hour and a half, and when he finished, I was the first one to ask him a question because of my position on the committee. And what you're saying is you want the Congress to vote X number of dollars. He wouldn't put a figure on it in the secret briefing. And you believe that this will give South Vietnam a shot in the arm, and we'll find out before any of that money ever gets out there whether they're going to stand and fight. And if they do over the next two or three months while we're getting it ready to go, the ammunition and the helicopters and so on, then you think it ought to go in there. And if they don't, it'll be too late to send any of it anyway. Is that what you're saying to us? And he said, yeah, that's what I'm saying to you. So I think that's what the president was saying, too.
Well, the thing that disturbed me is to think that we spent $150 billion in that country and another $722 million will turn it around.
No, it won't turn it around, Jerry. You and I both know that. And if we spent another $150 billion under the same conditions, it wouldn't turn around either. You can't fight a limited war by giving your opponents a sanctuary at which, when they get clobbered, they can retreat and you don't touch them. I sat around a big conference table in the cabinet room at the White House in the early months of 1965. Lyndon Johnson had 40 people there, members of Congress, all 40 of whom had been out to Vietnam. I didn't think that made us experts, and I was very unlucky because he grabbed me by the arm as we came in and put me down on his left, and then he started on his right, and I had to listen to all 39 of the others, and kind of sit, including a 15-minute speech by the then Senator Young from Ohio, which added up to exactly zero. Lest you think I'm being political, he was a Democrat. And when it came my turn, I just said very briefly, Mr. President, there's just about three observations I'd like to make. You're supposed to be a great historian. I was a history major at the university, and you're trying to do what Abraham Lincoln tried to do, and I don't want to raise any hackles here, but my grandfather was a Confederate soldier, too. So I said, you're trying to run a war out of that Oval Office next door, half a world away. I said, Lincoln tried to run one just across the river for 3 years and found out he couldn't, and he got the biggest drunk in the Union Army and put him in command and said, win the war. Now, somebody said to Lincoln, Grant drinks a lot. And Lincoln said, tell me what brand he drinks and I'll get some for all my generals. But I said, if you ought to do one of two things, Mr. President. I'll get to the point, ladies and gentlemen. I said, you ought to either win this war within the next 2 weeks, which you can do. You've got the ultimate weapon. You used it, we used it on Japan, or you ought to get out. There's no middle ground. And And he chose not to use it, and he chose not to get out. And I might tell you that I added as a postscript, if you don't do one or the other, it'll destroy you, and it may destroy the Democratic Party, and it'll divide the country, because Americans are not patient, and they're not going to put up with a war that goes on forever.
With regard to Henry Kissinger, and of course I know you're a good friend of him. I've been in the White House when you and the Secretary were jibing each other back and forth. But don't you think a lot of people are fearful that he's lost his great star, so to speak, failing to realize that he was the only star we had during Watergate?
Well, Jerry, I think you put your finger on it exactly right. Not only that, he got the Egyptians and the Arabs and the Israelis to talk, and he's had some successes, but he's not Superman. Nobody's going to win them all in international diplomacy. Not even Metternich did that, you know.
I think that back at the Watergate, there was nothing he could do wrong because everybody was looking for somebody. Everybody else was tarnished, and now Watergate is not there. I think they're finding he is indeed human. I don't think it means that he's lost his ability.
Well, the Eastern establishment press and the columnists who write for it, all of whom believe they're a first cousin to God, have not got anybody left to pick on, you know. I'm just small fry, so he's bigger game.
Here.
Congressman, what do you perceive to be the final end result in Vietnam?
Are you asking me?
I think either one of you.
Well, I'll tell you what I think. I think it's going down the drain. I think the communists are going to take it over, and I think they're going to mold it into a communist state as they have North Vietnam. And if whoever's running it is corrupt, we won't know anything about it because there won't be any American newspaper men there to report it.
I think it's going down the tube. I think it would have gone down the tube, frankly, anyway. I think it's just a matter of time. Whether we wanted it to go after we spent $150 billion or after we spent $200 billion. The thing that bothered me is that, number one, the same countries that criticized us for getting into Vietnam are now criticizing us for getting out.
Following your discussion here through to the conclusion, where does this leave the United States then, foreign policy-wise, as a world power? Are we substantially weakened, or do we merely pull our defense lines back and hold the line from there, say Hawaii and the South Pacific? What's your opinion on that, on the long run?
I really think the decision about whether we're going to be a world power or not will come over the Azores, and I'm not optimistic about what our decision will be if Portugal, as I believe it will, goes communist, and if the Soviets move in to establish a missile base on the Azores, and we don't tell them to be on your way, we're here and we're going to stay. Then I think we'll have a Soviet missile base in our front yard, and I think we'll be immobilized. I'm not optimistic that the present administration will have the intestinal fortitude to do what needs to be done. I know what Harry Truman would have done. I know what he did do in Greece and Turkey. But I don't know what this administration will do. I'm afraid what they'll do is allow it to happen.
The things that bothered me in President Ford's statement on foreign policy is that he indicated that a reevaluation of our foreign policy was really theory, and that we had to deal with the real world. And it disturbed me because I think that continuing our foreign policy based on the situation that existed in the 40s is not really dealing with the real world. The real world is to deal with it as it is right now, and I would like to see us reevaluate and rethink our total foreign policy based on the situation as it is now, rather than just a continuation of what we've had for the last 30 years.
Congressman Hayes, how do you feel about the recently revived interest in the Kennedy assassinations?
Well, I think about 90% of the revival of that interest is done by fellows who can see that there's a pot of gold at the end of that trail and that they're really cashing in on it. We've had one down at the university in my district who came there with the Zapruder films, which everybody's seen 100 times, and he showed them and showed them in slow motion and had 2,000 kids who were there believing that Kennedy was shot from both sides. Now, people who are knowledgeable about such things say that if you get shot from the rear, that your head goes forward first and then there's an involuntary reaction that jerks back, or vice versa. I don't know much about it. I never shot but one guy, and I was so scared then that I wasn't paying any attention to what his reaction was, except I wanted to make sure he fell, because he was threatening to kill me first. But I think it's 90% promotion. I want to know my personal opinion about it.
Is there any possibility that Congress could get the President to put forth a program so that we would not have another, quote, Vietnam, and still have a maintenance or a strength or a status in the world so that we could balance between over-advancement of the past and entrenchment or isolation in the present? Either one. Thank you.
Well, I think we went from the Truman Doctrine, which was a doctrine of limited American protection of people who are willing to fight for themselves, to becoming the world policeman. And I think we overextended ourselves. I recall being called down at the White House, Jerry, when the Cuban Missile Crisis was in effect, and I guess I was about the only one in the room who told Kennedy that the Russians wouldn't fight if he ordered them to get the missiles out of Cuba. He said, "Why do you say they won't fight?" I said, "Mr. President, if this were Poland or Czechoslovakia, they'd be fighting. In fact, Washington probably wouldn't be here right now. But they're not going to risk the total loss of every city in Russia over an island 100 miles from the United States. And you can just count on it, they'll pull out."
1976 is not too far away, and there's about a half a dozen declared candidates for the Democratic nomination. Who do you rate as the front runner? Who do you rate as a dark horse? And how do you see it? Senator Benson was here. How do you look at the pack in general?
I look at them all as dark horses right now.
I don't think I can improve on that.
We had Scoop Jackson here. As I travel around, I think the people are still looking. I really do. It bothers me that the Democratic Party and Republican Party, often in the past, has simply taken a look at two or three people that propel themselves up for consideration and never go much deeper than that. They just take whatever two or three want to be considered, and I'd like to see them look a little deeper than they have. We're looking a little deeper this time. Maybe Watergate, maybe disenchantment, maybe the economy, maybe all of these things, maybe the nostalgic feeling we have in this country of wishing things were like they were in the 30s when we really don't know how they were in the 30s, many don't. Maybe we're looking for something that's not there. Maybe we're looking for a candidate that doesn't exist. Maybe we've set our goals higher than is attainable. Maybe we're looking for some kind of messiah and he doesn't exist or is not willing to run this time. I'm of the opinion we may have our goals a little too high, and we may have to recognize that we're going to have to nominate a human being that's got weaknesses and strengths like everybody else. But in the meantime, I don't think the American people have picked their man, and I haven't either.
Well, Jerry, I don't want to go back to the 30s. I remember them.
I don't want to break into this political discussion, but what do you think of Henry Kissinger's motions to recognize Cuba, one, and his interest in starting consultation with Panama to turn over the Panama Canal to them?
First place, I don't think that we can deny that Cuba exists, and I think we ought to trade with them and recognize that they're there and they're viable, and I'd much prefer to talk and trade with people than to fight, and I think if you're going to fear something, you fear those things you don't understand. You certainly don't understand those things you don't talk to or trade with. I think it's about time we start trading and talking with Cuba. As far as Panama, that bothers me a little bit. I would hate to give up many of the things that are very important to us with regard to the Panama Canal Zone.
Well, I generally concur with what Jerry said. Cuba's there, and you can't deny it's there. You know, there it is. You can look out on a clear day almost and see it from the Florida Keys, and we're doing business with bigger communist countries in Cuba, and I think that we ought to have relations with Cuba. We ought to exchange ambassadors, but I would treat them like I treat all communists, with great caution and care, and never turn your back on them. And as far as the Panama Canal is concerned, I'll go along with Jerry a little further. I think it's absurd to, and it isn't Henry Kissinger. This negotiation was going on before he ever got to be Secretary of State. I don't think he wants to give it up any more than I do. We have a treaty in perpetuity, and I think we ought to sort of just stick to it.
Do you think he's really just trying to pacify the Panamanians? I don't think he really wants to give up.
Well, I think he's trying to pacify some of the extreme left liberals in Congress more than he is the Panamanians. You know, the Panamanians don't have any votes or any army either, so why should he worry about that?
I'm Merle Weisenborn from Southern Platte County, and we must be through over our recession. We haven't had many questions on domestic economics. But my question is, it's told, or some people say, that one thing the Congress administration is in agreement on is they're bound and determined to spend themselves back into office with dollars they don't have. Is this true, and is this the stand of each of you?
Well, I don't think it's true. I didn't vote for the tax cut. Gee, I don't know what's going to happen to me when they find that out back home. But, you know, I just couldn't see giving everybody $100. It's going to be nice to get that check, but when you get it, are you going to go out and buy a new car or a new television set? You're probably going to pay the back utility bill where they ripped you off from the high prices of oil and coal. And I don't think that's really going to stimulate the economy, and I thought the thing was structured wrong, and I had a speech that day, so I just went on and made the speech back home. So I don't think that this is Congress's motivation, and I haven't changed my position. I went to Congress and was called a left-wing radical in 1948. My platform was then that the United States of America doesn't owe anybody a living. But it... but it does owe every able-bodied citizen the opportunity to earn a living. And that's my platform today, and they call me a reactionary right-wing conservative. So I haven't changed apparently as much as the press has.
Yeah. Talk about the press and talk about the right to earn a living. I remember the New York Times had an editorial many, many years ago about Caruso and about democracy. And they concluded that democracy really didn't owe anybody success, that all the democracy could ever hope to give to people, free people, was a chance to see that every Caruso had a chance to sing. And basically, I think that's all the government can do, to see that every Caruso has a chance to sing, every farmer has a chance to produce, every worker has a chance to work, everybody has a right to use the talents they have.
And every Dr. Salk has a chance to find a vaccine for polio. You know, you could go on and enlarge on that, and I concur wholeheartedly. That's probably the only editorial the Times has written in the last 20 years that I do concur with.
I would like to say that our guest next month is a gentleman that certainly will be able to discuss with us the problems of South Vietnam and Cambodia and the military affairs, because our guest will be Bo Calloway, the Secretary of the Army. And I know there'll be some interesting questions from this group then. I hope you can be with us. The meetings are indeed open to the public. If you'd like to attend the meetings, write my office. We'll tell you when the meetings are held. If you can't, we hope you join us on the some 20 television and radio stations that carry Dialogue with Litton. So we'd like to ask you to be back with us next month when we again bring government to the people.
Can I put in a plug for Bo Calloway?
Yes.
I want you all to come with some good, tough questions, because he's a Georgia Democrat turned Republican, and he deserves them.
Missouri Congressman Jerry Litton invites a well-known public figure to come to Missouri and join him in an unrehearsed two-hour question and answer open to the public town meeting. This has been a 30-minute edited portion of this month's meeting. Dialogue with Litton is presented on this station monthly in order to keep you better informed as to what is going on in our government.